W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of Daughters of the Storm by Elizabeth Buchan, narrated by Helen Stern. Calais, November 1793. There hadn't been a storm like it for years. Sophie stood by the casement window of the inn and looked out over the sea. Every so often, as the spasms grew more insistent, her hands tightened on her swollen belly. It seemed to her that the water was full of blood and that its noise was a moaning of prisoners. Their cries would not let her rest. They were branded into her memory, just as the pains were taking over her body. "It was too much," she murmured, "too much of everything. Blood, death, fear." Down below, a door banged, and she knew it was her husband with the midwife. She turned with difficulty, using her arm to support herself against the wall, and tried to walk over to the bed. She recoiled as she brushed against one of the many cobwebs that festooned the room, and at the sight of the bed with its soiled sheets. She did not want to lie on it, but she knew she must. She forced herself to take a step forward, and the process took an age. Gasping, she heaved her ungainly bulk onto the sheets, swung her legs up, and lay back with a sigh. The unaccustomed sensations washed over her, and she sank onto the pillows, allowing them to take her where they wanted. Downstairs in the kitchen, all was frantic activity. Two kitchen maids staggered into the room with a basket of wood. It was already tropically hot, but they piled more logs onto the fire, and the flame leapt up under the cauldrons of water, which were suspended on the cast iron spit. Her husband watched as the midwife divested herself of her dripping outer clothes. "Hurry," he said tersely. The midwife nodded as she rubbed herself dry. The cook stood by anxiously. "Mon Dieu, what a night for a birth," she said, going to the cupboard where she pulled out a large white apron. "You will need this," she said, tying it around the midwife's waist. Upstairs, the bedroom was quiet. Sophie imagined for a moment that she was back in Paris, and she was sure she could smell chocolate made hot and thick as she liked it. She could hear the clop-clop of wooden sabots in the street outside. Then the pain closed in again, tugging at her flesh, and her vision dimmed. She heard a moan, forced out of torment, and was surprised to realise that the sound came from her. "What is happening?" she wondered. Then she remembered she was having her baby and it was coming too early. She had tried to stop it, but it had been no use. She raised her head from the filthy pillow and saw a figure bending over a basin, pouring something from a jug. She felt the heat of the fire and turned her head to the side. Someone was bending over her with a cloth to wipe her sweating face. She sensed who it was. "Hush," said her husband, his voice hoarse with strain. "Hush now. It won't be long." Sophie made a gigantic effort. "Am I?" she whispered. "Is it all right?" "It is well," said the midwife, placing a hand on her stomach. "You must be patient." Sophie moved restlessly. "Patient? With this?" She fell back and tried to find a place to hide, away from a strange half-world peopled with whispering memories and ghosts. "It is time to examine her," the midwife said, and her husband helped to lift Sophie higher onto the pillows. He stroked back her long, tangled hair and made a clumsy effort to braid it. Sophie brushed his hand away with a cry. The midwife rolled up Sophie's linen shift and her swollen body leapt into relief. The white thighs were streaked with blood and the distended belly contracted visibly. "It is coming," said the midwife. "Lift her up." He went to raise her up and eased his shoulders between Sophie and the bed. "This is what it is like to die," thought Sophie, her head hanging down onto her breast. "But I haven't said my prayers. Dear God, she began, but a roaring in her ears and a burning, splitting sensation blotted out conscious thought. She was back in Paris again, to a time when death smelt in the hot sun, and the noise of marching feet rent the peace of the nights, and the thud of falling heads sounded into the breathless silence of watching crowds. Somewhere among it all was Héloise, but she didn't know where. She strained to find her, but Héloise eluded her, and Sophie couldn't remember what had happened. The baby was not coming as quickly as it should.
"Turn her on her side," the midwife said quietly.
He obeyed, shifting Sophie's heavy body awkwardly. A log on the fire broke in half with a crack, and the flame spurted higher, sending a shadow flickering up the wall.
"Try to push," said the midwife.
"I can't," Sophie gasped. "I can't. Oh, but I can't. I can't." The midwife's hands darted between her legs and cupped gently at the head emerging between them.
"It's almost here," she said reassuringly. "Easy." With a slither, the baby arrived and Sophie subsided into the arms that held her.
Her husband laid her down and went to look as the baby was lifted clear.
"A boy," said the midwife. "Madame, a boy."
There was a hush for a good few minutes. Then Sophie's exhausted face puckered as the pain gripped her again. She cried out, "It should be all over." It was all over.
"There's another," cried the midwife. "Quick!"
Sophie's husband took the baby from the midwife and cradled it in his arms, where it cried the desolate cry of the newborn. With infinite care, the midwife helped an even smaller, more delicate baby into the world and placed it on the bed, where its downy limbs jerked spasmodically. Sophie stretched out an arm with an effort, and her fingers brushed at its head. The midwife bent to cut the cord and then wrapped the baby in a shawl.
"There, little girl," she crooned. "It is over."
She laid it in the cradle, which stood waiting, and reached for its twin, arranging them so they lay together like tiny effigies. Sensing each other, brother and sister closed their eyes and lay still. Sophie was dimly aware of the midwife's hands busying themselves with the afterbirth. The peace was overwhelming, and a cocoon of contentment settled around her, cutting out the sights and sounds of the room. It wrapped her in its embrace, pressing her down into a haven where nothing could touch her. She closed her eyes. Small sparks of light filtered between her eyelashes, twisting and turning like petals in a breeze. "How strange," she thought. "It's like apple blossom. It's like high mulleins all those years ago, when she was another person in another time." The petals heaped gently onto her face, pushing her back. Part 1. The Rising Storm. May to October, 1789. Chapter 1. Sophie, May 1789.
"Sophie Maria," admonished her governess, "I must beg you to adjust your skirts."
Sophie looked down in some surprise. She had been thinking about other things. The beautiful spring weather, the way the apple blossom was tinged with pink, and of the scents that came with spring. Light, tangy scents that held infinite promise of sun-warm days and drowsy nights, when the warmth closed around you and lulled you to sleep. It seemed such a long time since she had felt like this, for the winter had been hard, and everyone, including the animals, had suffered from its iron grip. Now it was intoxicating to be out in the fresh, sunny air and to dream of summer. She brushed her skirts down over her ankles and settled herself more comfortably on the rug. Miss Edgeworth and she had come to an arrangement. A geography lesson would be so much better out of doors, Sophie had reasoned. So much more appropriate than in the small, darkly panelled schoolroom where they spent so much of their time. Miss Edgeworth had agreed, as Sophie knew she would.
Miss Edgeworth always welcomed a change in the routine, and goodness knows, there was little enough excitement in her life. Not that Miss Edgeworth complained, she knew her duty and her place, but she had not always been so resigned. Once there had beat a tiny pulse of hope and excitement in her breast. It had been quickly stilled. Poverty and her consequent lack of expectations had seen to that. But Miss Edgeworth remembered what it felt like to be 18, and so she had given in to Sophie's eager request, knowing that her excellent employers trusted her judgment. Indeed, the Luttrells, Sir Brinsley, and his French wife, Lady Emma, were unusual, in her experience, in the latitude they permitted their governess over matters concerning their beloved only daughter. Miss Edgeworth had no intention of betraying that trust. Neither did she have occasion for regret in taking up the post. For in Sophie, she found a willing pupil, who, if anything, had to be dissuaded sometimes from spending too much time with her nose in a book, or from scribbling for hours in her journal. Yes, Miss Edgeworth reflected for the thousandth time as she arranged her primers under one of the trees in the orchard. I've been fortunate in Sophie, who is as sweet-tempered as she is lovely. But in Miss Edgeworth's real opinion, it was a seriousness that underlay Sophie's youthful high spirits, the suggestion that here was a mind capable of feeling and compassion that gave Sophie a special quality. Rather disloyally, Miss Edgeworth regretted that Sophie was destined to spend her life at High Mullions as a dutiful wife and mother, although she did not doubt that Sophie would be perfectly content. Luckily for Miss Edgeworth, the subject of her speculations could not see into her governess's incurably romantic heart, for she would have been both puzzled and offended if she had. Sophie was very happy with her lot and far too innocent to question it. The only child of adoring parents, cherished, cosseted, and endowed with a loving temperament that evoked love in return, she had passed through an unclouded childhood and grown into a model daughter, whose only faults were a tendency to flare up when provoked, and an occasional bout of stubbornness. "Have you seen my cousin?" she was asking Miss Edgeworth. "He promised to take me riding." Miss Edgeworth had indeed seen Ned Luttrell, and if she was not mistaken, he had been making his way towards Wainwright's cottage, in which dwelt Wainwright's daughter, a remarkably pretty girl of some 17 summers. Ned had taken to visiting it quite often. It was a predictable development, but one, since she knew of Sophie's feelings for Ned, that needed to be handled carefully on her part. "It is time to continue our lesson," she replied, avoiding a direct answer. "Where was I?" "In France," replied Sophie, diverted, the name causing a frisson to go through her. "Ah, yes, in France." Sophie twisted a lock of fair hair round her fingers, a habit she had when she was thinking. France, a place of mysterious sophistication and allure, which she would soon be experiencing for herself. For as long as she could remember, the Luttrells had promised that she could make a prolonged visit, and now that Sophie was 18, the arrangements had finally been made. A year would be spent being launched into French society by her cousins and nearest relatives, the de Guinots, who were of the bluest blood. They were also rich, powerful, and close to the king. Spending time with them, Lady Luttrell had often insisted, would be the very best way of acquiring the polish that Sophie lacked at the moment. "Don't I please you as I am?" Sophie had once asked wistfully. Lady Luttrell had looked at her daughter and then grown serious. "Of course, ma fille. You please me more than you can possibly guess. But I have a duty to prepare you for life, and your father and I agree that a little knowledge of the world would be a good thing. Once that is accomplished, you may return to marry." Sophie watched Miss Edgeworth fumble in her basket for a handkerchief, and a little smile hovered round the corners of her lips. There had never been any question of whom she would marry. She would marry Ned, her adored second cousin, who had been brought up by the Luttrells after both his parents had succumbed to smallpox. As eldest surviving male descendant of his generation, Ned would inherit High Mullions. Lady Emma's inability to provide her husband with a son had seen to that. It was a cross that the Luttrells bore with dignity, even if they determined, in their quiet way, to ensure that the house, with its rolling, fertile land, would remain in their branch of the family. Happily, it was possible. Of course, if Ned had proved unsuitable, the Luttrells would not have dreamed of sacrificing their daughter. But Ned was more than suitable. 3 years older than Sophie, he was possessed of dashing good looks and a charm which could cajole even the most censorious into smiling. If his education sat lightly on him, he was also strongly opinioned, but good-humoured too, and had all the makings of an excellent squire and landlord. Brought up in the shadow of this godlike being, Sophie was easy prey, and in her eyes, Ned could do no wrong. The Luttrells told themselves that it would all work out perfectly. Safely netted in her loving family circle, with her dreams confined to her limited world, Sophie was entirely happy with the future that had been mapped out for her. And if Ned had any objections to the arrangement, he never voiced them. "Have you ever been to France, Miss Edgeworth?" she asked, wrenching her thoughts away from Ned. "Once," replied Miss Edgeworth unexpectedly. "I travelled around the country with my father. He was an agriculturalist, you know, and I accompanied him to help transcribe his notes. I've never forgotten it," she finished, and there was a wistful note in her quiet voice. "Did you?" said Sophie, sitting up. "What's Paris like?" "Crowded and very noisy. It's a beautiful city, even so. Very dangerous to walk in, and everybody who can travels by carriage or fiacre, so it is difficult to stop and admire the architecture. I'm very interested in architecture." Miss Edgeworth spoke absently, the memory of a promising young French architect whom she had once met and failed to excite, ever green in her thin, unloved breast. "The streets are so narrow that I was sometimes in fear of my life. The hostelries are expensive, dirty, and full of vermin. But the area you will be staying in is distinguished by some fine houses. And," she added dryly, "I don't expect you will be walking anywhere." But Sophie was not listening. She had seen Ned coming towards them from the house. Her heart leapt and she sprang to her feet and waved. "Sit down, Miss Luttrell, if you please," commanded Miss Edgeworth. Sophie obeyed reluctantly and once again arranged her disobedient skirts. Ned appeared at the gate which led into the orchard and vaulted over it. Sophie bit her lip. He was so very handsome in the short green coat that he favoured, despite the fact that his light brown hair was tied back untidily by a black ribbon. He was wearing a pair of well-worn top boots and carried his flat-topped hat in his hand. Ned never gave any care to his appearance, but somehow it did not matter.
"The two handmaidens of spring, I see," he called out good-naturedly as he walked towards them. Miss Edgeworth blushed despite herself, and Sophie raised a radiant face.
"You have come to take me riding after all," she said.
Ned pressed the corners of his mouth down into a mock grimace.
"Good heavens, I'd quite forgotten," he said ruefully, tugging at his cravat, which was half undone. "In fact, I've arranged..."
Sophie's face fell.
"Now, don't take on, Puss," he said. "We'll go if you wish. But I came to tell you that I shall be escorting you both to Paris and staying over for a while. Your father has finally persuaded me. Does that please you?"
Sophie whirled to her feet and threw her arms around him.
"Indeed it does," she said, the words tumbling out in her excitement. "I can't think of anything I would like better."
Ned disentangled himself.
"Careful," he said. "You're in danger of strangling me."
Sophie released him at once, and some of the joy died out of her face. She knew that he had not meant to, but Ned's protest had made her impulsiveness appear awkward and childish.
"Miss Edgeworth," said Ned,
consulting a gold half-hunter watch from which dangled two fashionably heavy fobs.
"I will take my cousin riding now. I'm sure Lady Luttrell will excuse Miss Luttrell the rest of the lesson."
There was no mistaking the note of command in his voice. Miss Edgeworth hesitated, torn between insisting that he wait and the tempting vision of having some time to herself. Indulgence won. "An hour only, then, sir, if you please," she contented herself by saying. She retrieved some sewing out of her basket and made every sign of getting on with it. But as soon as Sophie and Ned were safely out of sight, she allowed it to drop and sank back with a sigh. "Will you stay long in Paris?" asked Sophie, scrambling after Ned as fast as her dress would permit, delighted to have him to herself.
"For a while."
He was amused by her obvious excitement. "But we will have some time together. You will escort me to balls and take me riding, and perhaps we can arrange to see some of the sights."
Sophie's voice betrayed her nervousness at the prospect of being left entirely alone in Paris.
"Of course," Ned spoke with a trace of regret. "That is why I agreed to your father's request to accompany you. But I don't care for the notion of being away for too long. Something might go amiss. In fact, Sophie, I don't mind telling you I took a little convincing. All that worry and fuss, and I don't fancy the notion of foreign food."
"Ned," Sophie exclaimed, "surely you don't mean that. Doesn't the thought of all those strange and wonderful places entice you a little? High mullions will be all right. After all, Papa has managed it all his life."
"Not particularly," he said, laughing at her. "This jaunt will seriously disrupt my summer. I don't really see the need for it, and I have a perfectly good social life here. Miss Edgeworth and our Frenchy cousins will look after you. You will buy a new wardrobe, acquire some admirers, and start spouting the lingo all the time instead of half the time. In short, you will thoroughly enjoy yourself. As for me, I don't see the point of acting like a damn monkey at some French ball or other, when I'm needed to oversee the crops."
Ned was only telling her half the truth. The vision of Margaret Wainwright's black hair and rounded breasts occupied the other half. Sophie coloured.
"I would never permit admirers," she said hotly. "Never. And I'm surprised you're not more anxious to take me to Paris."
Ned paused. They were standing on the path that led up through the garden towards the south aspect of the house.
"Sophie, I don't think you quite understand. Looking after high mullions is a serious business, and as you know, your dear papa isn't exactly receptive to the improvements I've proposed. Not that I'm not devoted to him," he added hastily.
Touched by his confidence, Sophie nodded. She quite understood, or thought that she did, the unspoken undercurrent of tension that flowed between the older and younger man. It worried her sometimes, for she did not care to think of her beloved father being displaced. It was true that Ned took care not to appear too impatient or tactless with regard to Sir Brinsley, who, after all, had offered Ned a home and seen to his wants. But she knew that Ned often felt very constricted by his more conservative uncle. Still, if Sophie was honest, she understood Ned's feelings. Sir Brinsley was not always willing to try out new ideas, and it was only natural that the two should fall out from time to time.
"Perhaps you're right," she said thoughtfully.
Ned flicked at her chin with a careless finger.
"Of course I am, Puskin," he said,
kindly enough. But Sophie was miserably conscious that his attention had wandered away from her.
"You must trust my judgment," he added. "Now, go and get changed before I change my mind."
20 minutes later, Sophie gave a critical glance in the mirror to reassure herself. Cased in the tight crimson broadcloth of her riding habit, she was as slim and as supple as ever. Pushing the skirt around with one booted foot, she stood in profile to make sure the line of her habit followed her figure. It did, to perfection. Not a wrinkle or a bulge marred the outline of her body, and only the tumbling muslin of her jabot broke its symmetry, its snowy folds and intricate knot adding a teasing sumptuousness to the severity of the costume. Sophie was reasonably satisfied. She gave one last tug to her skirt, arranged her hat at a jaunty angle, and picked up her whip. The sun felt unseasonably hot as a small party, composed of Ned, Sophie, and Bragg the groom,
set off up the hill towards the ridge at the top, and even the disapproving face that Bragg habitually wore wasn't enough to dampen their spirits. The trees were thick with their new leaves, and the apple blossom was sending its petals down in a thick rain. They caught in Sophie's hat and jabot, and she brushed them away. The ill-made road wound up a steep hill past the outlying cottages of the estate, and as they mounted upwards, Sophie twisted in the saddle to look back at her home. Mellow and beautiful, High Mullions sat securely on its slight incline, its lawns rolling up to the windows, and the pink-red brick wall that bordered its gardens glimmered in the distance. All was well. At the crest of the hill, they swung left towards Bluebell Wood and vied with each other to see who could catch the first sight of the famous carpet of blue. Overhead, a cuckoo sounded, and the soft whir of a bird's wings flurried as they passed and then settled again. A slight breeze sprang up, cooling the air, but even so, the shade was refreshing. They picked their way in single file along the track between the trees and emerged onto high ground, which gave them a view of the river plain in the distance. Sophie was content. There was nothing she liked better than to ride out into the country that she considered her territory. The late spring was quickening all that she saw, and the woods and fields were stirring with new life and colour.
"I'm going to pull down Henchard's cottage," said Ned, waving his whip in the direction of a small brick building, "and enlarge the field."
"You're not," exclaimed Sophie. "Where will Henchard go?"
"He can rent the spare cottage over by Wakehurst Mill."
"But that is 5 miles from here, and Henchard is too ill to be taken from his home. You can't mean it, Ned."
Sophie, who knew the Henchard family well and often visited them, contradicted him without thinking.
"Nonsense, Sophie. He will have to do as he is told," said Ned. "I'm not ill-treating him. The Wakehurst cottage is in much better condition, you know."
"But Ned, you don't understand. The cottage is his home. He is comfortable there. You can imagine what he will feel."
"Don't be foolish, Sophie. My plans will suit him well enough in the end."
Ned smiled to take the sting out of his words. Sophie stared at him, anguished at the thought of the old man being chased from the only home he had ever known, and perplexed that Ned didn't understand. But as she looked at him, the realization dawned, as it did with increasing frequency, that there was nothing to prevent Ned doing exactly as he pleased. Ned was going to be master at High Mullions, and her place was to obey him, not to dictate. She pricked her horse onwards, an uncharacteristic bitterness rising in her for the accident of her sex. Ned regarded her from behind with a quizzical expression. He was fond of Sophie, of course, and fully intended to make her a good husband, but he found her whims and impulses irritating at times. He was very happy to leave the running of the house, even the accounts, to his wife, and he would make an effort not to interfere with the children. But the estate was his domain, and she should learn to accept it.
"Don't poke her up, Sophie," he called out. "You must leave these decisions to me."
She glanced back at him.
"You are wrong to do this," was all she said.
At her wrathful expression, Ned burst out laughing and spurred his horse.
"You'll get wrinkles if you frown," he said infuriatingly. "How about a gallop?"
For an answer, Sophie leant over her mare and touched her sides. Her mount leapt forward to the accompanying thud of Ned's horse's hooves.
"Faster," she breathed. "Faster."
She flashed past the line of trees to her right, the mare skimming over the turf, her well-trained feet avoiding the rabbit holes. Suddenly, it was important to Sophie that she won this race. She gritted her teeth and made a mental calculation as to how far Ned was behind her. If she kept to the middle of the path, which was thickly wooded on either side, he would find it difficult to pass her. Sophie was not averse to using cunning, and she edged her horse further into the centre of the track.
"To the oak tree at the end," she shouted. "I will beat you by a head."
"No, you won't, by God,"
Ned answered and spurred his horse with a raucous yell. Sophie concentrated on her horse and the deceptively smooth lie of the ground in front, all other considerations dissipating in the wild rush of air that beat at her cheeks
and the powerful stride of the animal beneath the saddle. She swerved past a fallen tree, put up a hand to secure her hat, and was nearly unseated. Her mare, however, did not let her down, and with Sophie using every ounce of skill she possessed, the distance between the two horses lengthened, until at last she reined in, flushed and triumphant, under the tree. Ned thundered up.
"Well ridden," he called. "I'll say this for you, Sophie, there is none to beat you in the saddle."
Considerably more in charity with her cousin, and restored to her customary good humour, Sophie allowed Ned to lead her blown mare and the long-suffering Brag along the track and down into a small valley, where they wound alongside the stream towards High Mullions. Once back in the stable yard, Sophie let the reins go slack and waited for Ned to lift her down. As she did so, she saw the figure of Margaret Wainwright slip into the yard, where she stood staring at the party and giggling when Ned's reins became tangled in his whip. Sophie liked Margaret, so she gave a friendly wave and slid down into Ned's waiting arms. "Goodness, Ned, how flushed you are," she said. Sophie often thought of that ride during the months that followed, and caught her breath at the memory of a time when she had been uncomplicated, ignorant, foolish, and young. After an early dinner, the Luttrells kept country hours, she sat with her mother in the drawing room which overlooked the lawn. The long windows trapped every trace of late afternoon sun and warmed the room. Sophie was drowsy from her ride, but made an effort to get out her sewing and concentrate on a pile of white work that needed repair. They had dined well, and the men were still at the table, occupied by a bottle of port that required careful attention. Lady Luttrell had chosen her moment carefully. "Sophie," her charmingly accented English caught Sophie's ear for the thousandth time. Lady Luttrell would never speak English well, despite having lived in England for nearly 20 years. Nor did she wish to. And since Sir Brinsley spoke excellent French, Lady Luttrell's less than perfect grasp of her adoptive language had posed no bar to a successful marriage.
"About your cousins in France, ma chère, I think we should discuss them a little."
Sophie laid down her needlework, always glad of an opportunity to do so.
"I'm all attention, maman."
"Naturellement, you do not know them well, apart from what I have told you. I too have lost touch a little, although my sister, your tante Marguerite, and I correspond regularly. Perhaps one day I might, after all."
Lady Luttrell's voice trailed into silence, and Sophie, ever quick to sense her mother's moods, knew she was longing for her country.
"Tell me more, maman," she said to divert her.
"In France, things are ordered differently," Lady Luttrell continued after a moment. "Daughters, par exemple, are not free to say and do as they please, as is more the custom over here. A custom that your father and I approve of, and we have always allowed you to speak your mind, within reason. But you will have to watch your tongue and take care to observe how your cousins, Cécile and Héloïse, behave, and try to copy them. I don't want you to feel too restrained, but I want you to be a credit for us."
"To us," Sophie interposed from force of long habit.
Her mother frowned at her. "To us," she repeated with dignity, and switched into French.
"What was I saying? Ah, yes, your Aunt Marguerite is strict in her views."
"What is she like, maman?"
Sophie tossed aside her ill-treated sewing and settled herself more comfortably. Lady Luttrell reflected for a moment.
"She was the beauty of us two. So beautiful that men would stop and stare openly. I used to be quite jealous of her until I married, and then I knew that I had more than enough to be content."
Lady Luttrell smiled, a tender, disarming smile.
"The De Guinots," she continued, "have many estates, a beautiful house in Paris, and the apartments in Versailles. I hope you will visit La Joyeuse, their chateau near Paris. I thought it a most exquisite place."
"But my cousins, what of them?" asked Sophie.
"I know as much as you do, chérie. I've seen them once, that time your aunt brought them to us here."
Sophie had a distant memory of two rather proper young girls who refused to climb trees.
Her chief recollection was one of exasperation.
You must remember, said Lady Luttrell gently, that you are an ambassador for your country, and what you say or do will reflect on us in a noticeable way.
Yes, maman,
said Sophie obediently, rising in a soft frou-frou of muslin and going over to the window. She sighed.
Does anything trouble you, ma fille?
Asked her mother. Sophie turned and went to sit down beside her on the comfortable sofa, over which Lady Luttrell had flung some pretty striped calico as a cover. She fingered it restlessly.
No, nothing, she said. But we have been so happy as a family, have we not?
Yes, yes, we have. We have been blessed.
Sophie thought for a moment.
And I shall marry Ned?
That is our dearest wish.
Sophie gazed past her mother, the low shafts of the dying sun tipping cheeks flushed with health and exercise. Her grey, thickly lashed eyes opened wide, and in their depths lay a troubled expression which alarmed her mother.
Sophie, you do wish to marry Ned?
Sophie shook her head to banish a doubt that had crept unwanted into her mind. Why had Margaret Wainwright been at the stables when they came back from their ride? And was she imagining it, or had Ned given Margaret a little nod, which she had thought nothing of at the time?
Sophie, repeated her mother, you are happy about Ned.
Sophie looked at her and tried to think clearly. Was it possible that Ned was conducting an intrigue with Margaret? No, she was being fanciful.
I wish for nothing more, she said at last.
You are sure?
She smiled to reassure her mother.
Yes, she said,
and meant it.
Then why do you look like that?
I was thinking, said Sophie slowly,
fumbling for some sort of answer.
I shall change, shall I not, over a year? I wish to visit France very much, but it won't be the same when I return. I shall be different, and I hope it won't spoil our happiness.
Satisfied that Sophie was only expressing the normal doubts of a young girl about to embark on society, Lady Luttrell caressed Sophie's abundant fair hair and tugged at a small curl at the nape of her neck.
It is in the nature of things, she said. You must not be afraid. Rest tranquille, ma fille. Your father and I are quite sure that you will not let us down, either in France or when you return.
Comforted by Lady Luttrell's soothing words, Sophie let her cheek drop onto her mother's hand, where it rested for a long moment. Sophie was so sleepy that she decided to retire early that night, and after bidding her parents good night, she let herself into the hall to collect her candle. The dark had closed in, and she stopped by the wall table to light the candle before mounting the stairs to her room. She was attending to the wick, which needed trimming, and was surprised to see the figure of Ned appear at the top of the stairs. He was dressed in his overcoat and gave a start when her candle flared into the gloom.
Sophie, I didn't expect...
You going out, Ned?
She asked, cupping her hand to steady the flame, hoping that he would stay to talk to her.
For a while.
At this hour?
Curiosity did for the cat, dearest Sophie.
Ned was teasing, but it was clear to Sophie that he did not wish to discuss the subject.
Of course, she said hastily. I didn't mean to pry.
Good, he said, pulling the cuffs of his coat down over his wrists. You must be tired, Puss. You gave me a good ride, you know. Sleep well.
He patted her hand, set his hat on his head, dropped a kiss onto the top of her hair, and swaggered away down the corridor. Sophie stared after his departing figure, and a desolate feeling opened in the pit of her stomach. It was so intense that she was forced to grasp the banister for support until it passed. She began to mount the stairs and failed to silence the voice that whispered in her head what she knew now to be true. Ned was going to meet Margaret Wainwright. She pushed open the door of her room and set down the candle beside the mirror on her dressing table. Its reflection danced up the silvered glass, mocking her. She gazed into the mirror and ran her fingers across her cheek.
Surely she was not so ugly.
She dropped her head into her hands. Jealousy was not something Sophie had experienced before, but now it flamed unchecked through her, and her heart felt as heavy as lead. Ned didn't love her, and it hurt so much she could not bear it.
After a while, the first shock of her discovery receded a little, and she was able to sit up and look round the room, surprised to find that nothing had changed. Her innate good sense began to reassert itself. Of course Ned had been diverted, and she could not blame him. She had had so little opportunity to be with him these last 6 months. So much time had been taken up with lessons and with the business of preparing for France that he had failed to see that she had grown up. She could hardly blame him for seeking company elsewhere. But they would be together during the journey and in Paris, where she could enjoy his undivided attention, and then things would be different. Sophie took a deep breath. She must be sensible and forgive and forget this incident and never allow it to trouble her again. It would be difficult to do so, but do it she must, and with good grace. Heartened by her reflection, Sophie undressed. She threw a shawl over her nightrobe and moved the candle to a table by the window. She sat down, unlocked the drawer, and drew out a bundle of papers and arranged them in a pile. Then she removed the porcelain cover from the inkstand to reveal an inkpot and sand dredger underneath. Her quill was already trimmed, and she regarded it thoughtfully before dipping it into the ink. Normally, this was the time that Sophie loved best. Alone and unhindered, she could indulge in what had become important to her. It was something she never talked about and hoped that nobody would ever discover, because what she wrote was too private to be revealed. Sophie could not remember when exactly she had begun to scribble her thoughts down on paper, but hardly a day passed when she did not manage to find time to cover a sheet or so in her neat handwriting. Sometimes she was content merely to record the day's events. At other times, she tried to assuage the complicated feelings that unaccountably gripped her and left her puzzled and exhausted, and page after page would be scored out in despair when her pen failed to match her thoughts. Sometimes she turned to her small supply of books for inspiration, Robinson Crusoe and the daring philosophy of Rousseau's La Nouvelle Héloïse. But in the end, her need to express herself drove her to try once again. Tonight was different. Drawing the paper towards her, Sophie traced with her pen the words, "On being a wife, to obey my husband in all things. To..." Ned's image filled the room. Her pen faltered, and she swallowed back a treacherous lump in her throat. He was so very dear to her. How could he have? But no matter. Together they would rule over High Mullions, and it would be a place where peace and plenty reigned, and the estate would flourish under their dual care. Her pen travelled over the page, and her dreams went spinning into the future. Lady Edward Luttrell. Lady Edward Luttrell. Lady Edward Luttrell. Sophie wrote it over and over again and scrawled a determined black line under each word. Paris, July the 13th to the 14th, 1789. Change was in the air. It had been there for decades, forced underground by the royal police. It had lain, quiescent, but simmering, waiting for a signal. Few had dared to acknowledge it. That was to court exile or imprisonment. But now, throughout France, something had finally forced its way to the surface. A sense of expectation, of frustration and outrage. There it was, a small flame burning at the bottom of a pyre, fueled by the hunger of a country organized to favor a few and to forget the rest. It was unpredictable and heady, this feeling, and the newly elected representatives of the Third Estate of the Estates General, meeting for the first time in 150 years, who had made their way to Versailles in May 1789, were not immune to its seduction. Summoned by a reluctant king to help him make some sense of the financial crisis that threatened to swamp the country,
the representatives were hastily billeted on the hapless inhabitants of the town, bringing with them a flavour of provincial France and a medley of regional accents. Crowding into the already packed corridors of the great palace of Versailles, many of them ill at ease in the glittering, sophisticated throng, they debated and plotted with the fervour of those who considered themselves men of the hour. Many of them could ill afford the time spent away from their land and homes and longed for the comfort of familiar food and surroundings. But all of them, increasingly bitter at their political impotence, considered they had a duty to perform, and no amount of well-calculated snubs from their ecclesiastical or aristocratic superiors was going to deflect them from the business of making the voice of the Third Estate heard.
"We are given hope," declaimed Mirabeau, the fiery, ugly, eloquent noble who had crossed the floor to join the Third Estate. "We are given hope that we are beginning the history of man."
And in the days of political confusion that followed when the Estates General was reborn in the guise of the National Assembly, and during the years after when France erupted, many of them remembered his words. In the meantime, they had filtered down Paris's network of streets, inflaming emotions already at fever pitch. Men thumped their fists on tables in dens and drinking houses and held forth on the horrifying price of corn and the ever-present threat of a foreign army invading the capital. They harangued each other over the antics of the spendthrift bitch of a queen, the corruptions of the ministers, the sufferings of the people, and every so often they went on the rampage to the terror of their neighbours. In the most fashionable area of the city, the crowds gathered regularly in the gardens of the Palais Royal, fanning out between the lines of the trees and fountains. The press was often thickest round the cafes, and there were many who listened to a young lawyer holding forth on the night of July the 13th, 1789, from a table at the Café Froid. There was no trace now in his speech of the painful stammer which customarily afflicted him, as he called to the people to take their destiny into their own hands.
"To the Bastille," he cried. "Patriots, take action."
The crowd cheered and yelled its approval while the orator tossed his long curly hair out of his eyes and his yellowish complexion took on a pink flush of excitement. Desmoulins reached beneath his coat and with a dramatic flourish drew out two pistols.
"I will never fall alive into the hands of the police," he thundered. "They are watching us, citizens. Aux armes, mes amis."
Helped down from the table, he adjusted the green cockade in his hat, emblem of hope and liberty, and his listeners cheered him to the echo and surged into the streets. Within a few hours, the assault on the Bastille had begun. Chapter 2. Marie-Victoire, July 1789. Marie-Victoire rubbed her sweating forehead with her free arm. The other held a length of lace that she was ironing clamped onto a bench. Beside her, a growing pile of freshly pressed nightgowns and undergarments was stacked on a table, and another, even larger bundle lay as yet unpressed in the basket at her feet. She sighed. It would take an hour or more, at least, to finish her work, and she was hot and tired and longed to escape and walk in the fields before retiring to her attic bed. The heat in the kitchens was bad today. It spread like a thick covering through the rooms, normally so cool and dim, and sent tempers soaring and food to spoil. Through the door, she could see the maids heaving pans and dishes around the big kitchen, and hear Claude's petulant tones as he laboured to create yet another new dish to please his masters. She lifted the flat iron off the board and tested it with a wetted finger. It was too cold. Wearily, she made her way towards the great range, removed the second flat iron that was heating, put the first in its place and returned to her task. She ironed swiftly, for she had a real talent for this kind of work and did it with artistry and grace. Anything that came under Marie-Victoire's deft fingers underwent a sea change. Crumpled bits of linen turned into shirts, lace took on a new life, and the most complicated pleats and goffered edges fell effortlessly into place.
Mademoiselle Héloise, the youngest de Guinot, often remarked on this gift and encouraged Marie-Victoire to try her hand at dressmaking, and she was proving an apt pupil. Madame Cécile, Héloise's married sister, had declared that only Marie-Victoire might attend to her clothes whenever she resided at La Joyeuse. As a consequence, Marie-Victoire was kept busy through the daylight hours and often well into the night, for their demands were heavy. But she was thankful to have such a role to fulfill. It gave her purpose and helped her to deal with her grief for her mother, Marie, who had died the previous year, leaving her quite alone. Out of the corner of her eye, she saw a familiar figure creeping through the kitchen towards the drying room.
"What are you doing here?" she asked. "You should be with the horses."
"Looking for you, of course," replied Jacques Maillard.
The odours of the stable which he brought with him warred with the clean, starchy smell of her ironing. Marie-Victoire sighed again. Jacques was becoming a nuisance, and she wished he would leave her alone.
"Go away," she said crossly, banging down the iron and wiping her wet hands on her apron. "I have too much to do. Mademoiselle Héloise is expecting visitors from England, and I want to have everything of Mademoiselle Héloise's in order before they arrive."
"Come for a walk," he said. "I want to ask you something."
"Can't you ask me here?"
Jacques' chin took on an obstinate set, and his black eyes burnt with a look that was becoming all too familiar to Marie-Victoire. Obviously, another bee had settled in his bonnet. Normally, she was content to listen to what he had to say, and Jacques was becoming increasingly vociferous in his views, for he nourished ideas well above his station as a de Guinot stable lad. But today she felt too tired. Besides, she wanted to think her own thoughts, alone, in the soft quiet of the evening.
"Go away," she said again. "Another time, Jacques."
He frowned and made as if to speak, but then thought better of it. Marie-Victoire went on ironing.
"Look," he said at last, "I've got some bread and sausage. We could eat it together."
He held up a cloth-wrapped package. Marie-Victoire softened. Jacques looked so eager to please her, and it was a small request.
"All right," she said slowly. "If I have time, I will come and fetch you from the stables, but I won't promise anything."
Jacques' frown disappeared.
"Good," he said. "Don't forget. I shall be waiting."
She watched his tall, almost emaciated form disappear out of the kitchen. When finally she stacked the last chemise into the basket and went to lay the ironing on the racks to air, the evening was well advanced. The frenzy in the kitchen had reached a peak, for tonight the de Guinots were holding a card party to be followed by a late supper. Nothing too elaborate, for they were still in mourning for the Marquis's mother, the Maréchale de Guinot, who had died a couple of months previously, but it was enough to keep Claude at a pitch of hysteria. Marie-Victoire hovered at the kitchen door. Perhaps, after all, she could give Jacques the slip and pretend that she had gone straight to bed, or even that she had been required to attend the Marquis's. The idea was too tempting to resist, and with the ease of long practice, born from years of playing truant from her mother, she melted into the shadow thrown by the kitchen wing, skirted the yard, and struck out towards the fields that lay to the north of the chateau. Within minutes, she had reached her favourite meadow and stood leaning on the gate that led into the vineyard. The peace enfolded her in its embrace, and Marie-Victoire felt her body soften and relax with relief. She rubbed the back of her neck where it ached and hitched her skirts higher to enjoy the air playing around her ankles. Her head throbbed, and she pressed her fingers into the soft spot at her temples. After a minute or two, she looked up and stood gazing down the valley. "I shall miss this," she thought, and tried to imagine for the thousandth time what Paris would be like. It was so far away, 25 miles at least, an unknown place filled with noise and unaccustomed ways. Still, she was lucky to get the opportunity to see it, and she had better make the most of it. Unlike Jacques, Marie-Victoire had no illusions as to her place. Even if she had, Marie would have quickly done them out of her. Marie-Victoire was expected to serve the de Guinots, thankful for employment and a roof over her head. As such, she was sure of a regular supply of cast-off clothes and a kind word now and then,
which Mademoiselle Héloïse, at least, will be sure to give her. That and a place on one of the estates if she got too old or too ill to work any longer. It sounded well enough, and Marie-Victoire realised that her position was infinitely better than many she knew. A hand slid round her waist and she jumped.
"Thinking of me?"
said a voice from behind.
"Oh, it's you," said Marie-Victoire with a giggle. "You surprise me."
"I meant to," said Jacques Maillard darkly. "I've been watching you for some time. Why did you not come as you promised?"
Marie-Victoire shrugged at the tone of his voice. She had heard it often and knew it was best to ignore it.
"Because," she said flatly.
So, Jacques was in one of his moods. She felt too weary to humour him. It was one of the many things he demanded of her. "Sometimes I feel I know him so well," she thought, "and yet increasingly I don't understand him at all. In fact, there are times when he almost frightens me." She kept her eyes firmly ahead, waiting for a torrent of invective, and resolved to keep her temper. The son of the chief groom at La Joyeuse, Jacques had known Marie-Victoire all his life, and from the beginning had claimed her for his own. As grubby children, they had played in the fields and claimed the stables as their private territory. Neither of them had paid much attention to the others of their age, because they had found each other's company more than sufficient, and there were often pitched battles between them and hostile gangs.
"Who cares about them?"
Jacques would say, scrubbing his bloodied fists into his eyes.
"They are sheep."
And he would be even angrier if the more moderate Marie-Victoire showed signs of conciliation. As he grew older, he became more vehement. He had never liked La Joyeuse or the de Guinots, whom he saw as enemies to be fought with lies and guile, and he would spend hours describing to Marie-Victoire how he would escape.
"We are different," he told her. "We are going to do something with our lives. I'm going to take you away from here."
His arm would sweep out in a gesture that dismissed the estate.
"We shall not be lackeys forever."
Sensibly, Marie-Victoire would point out that they needed money to go, and neither of them possessed more than a couple of sous, nor were they likely to do so. But she would admire his courage in saying these things, and sympathise with the hunger for independence that lay behind the bluster. It was for Jacques' sake that she taught herself to read, huddled against the stable wall, where in winter the lantern swung on iron brackets and the light danced on the strange signs in front of her. And in summer, the sun's rays warmed her face and made her sleepy. She learnt quicker than Jacques, who was too impatient to be a good pupil, and it was Marie-Victoire who guided his hand down the text, listening to his halting syllables, and urged him to try just one more time. Jacques was better at arguing, though, Marie-Victoire had to concede, if reluctantly. Once Jacques had got hold of an idea, and his ideas were becoming more and more wild, he worried it like a dog with a bone. Then he would flood Marie-Victoire with a stream of words, leaving her to despair of ever being able to make him understand her point of view. She would throw a handful of hay over him instead, or chase him round the yard, which invariably ended with Marie-Victoire being caught and tickled. Strangely enough, Jacques was the only one who had understood what she had felt when Marie died. No one else at La Joyeuse had bothered much. They were too busy with their own concerns to waste time on the bereft girl. But Jacques, who had grown up without parents, his mother had died in childbirth, and his father treated him with the roughest indifference amounting to total neglect, had gone out of his way to let Marie-Victoire know that he mourned her too. But Jacques had changed. Always greedy for her time, he now demanded that she spend every free moment with him. He would stare at her in a way that she didn't understand and had come to hate, his narrow shoulders hunched and defensive. Sometimes he leant over her and his breath played on her skin. His cunning, unshaven face began to invade her dreams and she woke sweating and anxious to avoid him.
"What were you thinking of?"
Jacques asked, edging closer to her.
"Nothing much."
"You were," he said. "I can see it on your face. What was it? Tell me."
"It was nothing," she said again.
"Tell me. I demand it."
Marie-Victoire sighed.
"I was thinking of Paris, if you must know."
Jacques drew out the knife he always wore in his belt and began to whittle at a piece of wood. The blade scraped sharply against the green wood, and he peeled back the bark to reveal the pulpy core that lay underneath. Marie-Victoire reached over to take the knife from him and pointed it playfully at his breast.
"Careful," he said. "You might injure me."
She gave it back.
"I don't want you to go,"
he said eventually.
"Don't be silly, Jacques. I must go. I want to go. You should be pleased that I shall see more of the world. It's what you always said I should do."
Jacques' neck mottled a painful red.
"Your place is with me,"
he announced. Marie-Victoire looked up at him in genuine astonishment. Jacques' stomach contracted at the sight of the familiar face framed by light brown hair. Marie-Victoire was not beautiful, and her small body would probably grow sturdy with age. But her gold-tipped eyelashes and bright cornflower eyes were lovely, and she exuded a freshness that stirred his pulses.
"I mean it," he said. He cleaned the knife blade on his sleeve. "I want you for myself. We could run away to Paris and live cheaply. I'll find work."
He sensed rather than saw her recoil.
"I see," he said. "You don't want me. You'd rather spend your life with those cochons, running about emptying their slops from morning to night, or darning their chemise, or whatever you do. What will you have at the end of it? Nothing."
"I will have my work and a place in the house for as long as I am useful. It counts for much in my eyes," she replied.
"Don't make me laugh," said Jacques savagely. "They'll suck you dry and fling you out with the night soil like they do everyone round here. Look around you, Marie-Victoire. People like us don't count. We die early and worn out. Have you been to the village lately? Obviously not, or you wouldn't be talking like this."
There was enough truth in what he said to give Marie-Victoire pause.
"I shall see you often enough when I return," she said.
"No, you won't. I've made up my mind. That is what I wanted to talk to you about."
He flung the words out into the evening air and waited for a reply.
"I never promised you anything, Jacques."
She never liked to see Jacques hurt. Nevertheless, like an animal sensing danger, she wanted to run for home.
"I did not think I had to. Is it not plain what I feel?"
"What is it, then, that you want?" she asked.
But she knew very well. For an answer, he pulled her towards him, ignoring her protests. She beat at his chest.
"Stop it, Jacques. I'm too tired to be teased."
But Jacques, intoxicated by the smell of her body, bent his head and buried his lips in the nape of her neck.
"You shan't leave me,"
he muttered into the curve of her shoulder, tasting the warm skin with his tongue. Marie-Victoire struggled harder. Suddenly, she was very afraid. The stranger, who was showering her with kisses in places she had never been kissed before, had nothing to do with the boy with whom she had gone fishing on summer evenings, or pelted with snowballs on winter afternoons when the low-slung sun sent its weak rays over whitened land. She twisted frantically in his grasp.
"Stop it,"
she managed to say. The panic in her voice succeeded in arresting the hands that had found their way under her dress.
"Don't be stupid, Marie-Victoire,"
Jacques said, his eyes narrowing.
"You want me, really?"
Marie-Victoire disentangled herself and backed away.
"No, no, no, I don't."
There was no mistaking her fear.
"Leave me alone, Jacques."
For a moment, he was disconcerted, and she seized her advantage. She turned and stumbled up the path towards La Joyeuse. Jacques stared after her and bent to pick up his knife. He turned it slowly in his hands and then, with a sharp blow, drove it deep into the barrel of the gate where it stuck, quivering. He began to run. When she heard him behind her, Marie-Victoire's pace quickened. The long grass whipped at her legs, her heart pounded, and her breath came in sobbing gasps. He was too fast for her, she knew that, but fear lent her speed and she skimmed through a line of trees by the side of the meadow. She stumbled on a tuft of grass.
"Marie-Victoire!"
shouted Jacques. He lunged forward and caught at her skirts and with one quick movement felled her to the ground. The earth rose up to meet her. In an instant, he was on her. Marie-Victoire lay beneath him.
"Don't do this,"
she begged, her mouth crushed against his shoulder. but he did not, nor did he want to hear her. His knee forced its way past her twisted legs and jerked into the softest part of her. She screamed with terror, but no one heard. Jacques pinioned her with one arm. With the other, he forced her skirts up to her waist and found the places he was seeking.
"You will be mine," he whispered. "I will make you wish you had never heard of Héloise de Guinot. They have taken you from me, but they shouldn't have done. You are not theirs to take."
She struggled harder, but it was no use. Jacques fumbled at the laces of his breeches, and she felt him thrust between her legs, and her neck arched in silent anguish. It was all over in a minute. No sooner had he invaded her shrinking flesh than he jerked, groaned, and lay still, his face buried on her breast. Marie-Victoire lay motionless, except for her fingers which scrabbled at the grass beneath her body. "Never again will I be able to enjoy the smell of hay," she thought, "or the sight of scarlet poppies in the grass. They are tainted now with the smell of lust and the memory of an unwanted body on mine." Violation was pain that invaded the spirit as well as the body, and she knew, as she lay there with the wetness between her thighs drying in the hot air, that she hated Jacques Maillard. Presently, Jacques rolled over onto his side and lay without saying anything, his arms huddled over his head. Marie-Victoire inched her way to her feet and tried to staunch the blood that ran down her legs, but found herself unequal to the task. Her bruised flesh protesting at each step, she began to walk away, holding her torn bodice together as best she could. Jacques moaned.
"Marie-Victoire, forgive me," he muttered into the ground. "I never meant this."
She paused. "I will never forgive you," she said bitterly, without looking at him.
"Have you no pity?"
"Had you?" she replied. He raised his head and tears mingled with the dirt smeared on his face. Marie-Victoire did not bother to pick up her cap, which lay crushed in a patch of flattened grass. Nor did she give him a backward glance.
"Marie-Victoire!"
Marie-Victoire gritted her teeth and concentrated on the interminable way home. At the entrance to the stable yard, her knees gave way and she clung to the gatepost, surprised out of her trance by the sight that greeted her. Instead of the quiet evening routine of grooms settling horses, the yard was alive with activity. In the middle stood a foam-flecked horse, its rider nowhere to be seen. The stable boys fussed round it with hay and water, and a group of the de Guinot servants were talking agitatedly. No one noticed the small, crumpled figure that stood swaying by the gate. They were too busy discussing the news from Paris. Apparently, a huge mob had marched through the city to the old Parisian fortress prison of the Bastille, and after a day of fighting, had succeeded in storming it. They had killed the governor and released the prisoners who lurked in its gloomy cells. There were 7 in all. One of the de Guinot agents had ridden hot foot to inform the Marquis. Chapter 3. Jacques, July 1789. The beating had been a harsh one, and it had been administered by his own father. From the moment Héloïse had discovered Marie-Victoire in a faint outside her door and had demanded to know what had happened, Jacques' punishment had been unavoidable.
"Filthy pig," his father had said, raising the whip high. "Couldn't you have chosen a sensible wench, not a pampered favourite?"
Since Jacques's father was notorious for his indiscriminate lusts, the question was a formality.
"Like father, like son,"
Jacques ground out between bitten lips.
"Stupid bastard," said his father, bringing the whip down. "Stick to the village next time. They throw their scuds up without fuss, and if you pay them, so much the better."
The whip lashed onto his back, and with each blow, something was driven out of him, never to return. When at last Jacques staggered to his feet, the boy had gone, and in his place stood someone infinitely more dangerous.
"Fuck off," said his father indifferently. "Mind you don't put a foot wrong again. I don't want trouble." He laughed coarsely. It ain't your feet that's the problem.
Jacques clung to the lintel of the stable door and waited for the first agony to subside. Then, moving like an old man, he reeled inside and flung himself onto a pile of hay. It took 2 days for his wounds to scab over, and 2 more days for Jacques to make up his mind. Most of the time he lay fighting the pain while the vermin made free with his open wounds. Occasionally he fetched up at the kitchens for food, but the maids kept out of his way, repelled by the expression on his face and by his stinking, blood-matted clothes. His father left him alone. Marie-Victoire was ill, they said, confined to her bed in the attic, and she certainly wasn't going to see Jacques. Mademoiselle de Guinot had forbidden it. Would Marie-Victoire spare a thought for him? He wondered bitterly. Did she understand that he cursed himself for the fool that he was? Had she heard his despairing cry as she fled from him? In his heart of hearts, Jacques knew that she had, and that hurt worst of all. When night fell, he was fully clothed with his knife tucked into his belt. He eased himself upward, trying not to bend to avoid splitting his wounds, and made his way towards the kitchen wing. Once there, he shuffled into a stone passage that led between the larder and the stillroom, down to a small room at the end. He took out his knife and prized open the lock in the wooden door, a trick learnt long ago, and let himself in. A pile of candle ends lay on the shelf. He picked up one and sniffed at it. It was made of the best imported myrtle wax and gave off a delicate smell. Jacques knew that the de Guinots never stinted themselves over candles, and La Joyeuse often blazed with them, even if relatively unimportant visitors were expected. He rolled it thoughtfully between his fingers. Candle ends of such quality were in great demand, and it was pleasurable to think of the chief footman's anger when he discovered that his source of extra income had been raided. He stuffed as many as he could into a sack he had brought with him, tucked it awkwardly under his arm, and retraced his steps. Outside the kitchen he hesitated, and then slipped through the door. A basket of loaves lay on the sideboard, and he slid 2 into his sack. He turned to go and, as he did so, caught sight of a pile of silver teaspoons waiting to be cleaned. He pocketed 3 of them. The dogs, who knew him well, were quiet as he hobbled silently through the yard towards the back gates. It was easy. Jacques knew every stick and stone of La Joyeuse, and if he hadn't been so hampered by his back, he would have made swift progress. But his spirit sang with exhilaration at what he was doing. Safe in the woods at last, he flung himself down on his stomach and gave himself up to thoughts of revenge. He could never go back. His pride would never allow it, not even if it meant starving. No longer would he, Jacques Maillard, act as lackey to the family he hated, and no longer would they have power over him. He would find his own way and take a chance. Better death in the gutter than this life, which was no life. Jacques had talked often to the carriers who came from the city to collect produce, and they had told him a thing or two. Now he intended to make use of their advice. "I'll kill them. I'll kill them," he said aloud, and raised his face to the sky. There was no answer from the trees that hid him, or from the light wind that dried the sweat on his body. Jacques was alone. A week later, he joined the traffic that flowed along the road towards the northern entrance to Paris, and a good-natured wagoner gave him a lift for the last part of the way. Swaying with the movement of the cart, his face transparent with suffering, Jacques clutched his sack and watched the country slip away. A pulse beat in him that strengthened with each jolt. A certain knowledge that one day he would repay the de Guinots and claim back Marie-Victoire. Meanwhile, he would devote himself to making it possible. He didn't care how. The smell of the city hit him as he passed the barrier gates. Once inside the walls, he struggled to his feet, thanked his kind benefactor, and stood gazing at the close-knit houses and filthy roads. Then, following some primitive instinct, he disappeared riverwards, slipping into the tide of human flotsam that flowed down the streets and vanished into the vast pool of dispossessed humanity that washed through the capital. Chapter 4. Héloise, August 1789.
Héloise awoke abruptly. She lay on the lace-edged pillows and gazed up at the silk swags adorning the bed, listening to the early morning sounds. Outside, the yellow stone of the Hôtel de Guinot ripened into a deeper colour as the sun rose higher in the sky and the dawn birdsong faded. Her hands clutched the sheets, then lay motionless, and she closed her eyes, hoping that the blackness would quieten her beating heart and hold her safe for a few moments longer. Today, two things were going to happen. She would be introduced to Sophie Luttrell, her cousin, and she would be betrothed. A familiar sense of dread washed over her.
"Remember, your duty is to us," she heard her mother, the Marquise de Guinot, admonish. "The marriage will further our interests greatly. In fact, it is partly due to Monsieur le Comte de Choisy that I have been able to take up this post as minister. You must be reasonable."
Her father was less cold, but equally implacable on the subject. Reasonable? Héloïse's shoulders tensed. Was it fair that she was about to be sacrificed to her family's ambition? Even if it wasn't, she knew that it was unavoidable. The de Guinot family conducted themselves with assurance, ignored the wishes of everyone except themselves, and had grown used to being close to the seat of power. Personal feelings did not enter into the intricate business of dynastic marriages, and Héloïse was a fool to imagine that they did. There was a scratch on the door, and Marie-Victoire entered. Héloïse could escape awakening no longer. By 10 o'clock, she was dressed in a charming half-morning toilette of lavender silk over a white satin petticoat, which was laced at the back and drawn in tight at the waist with a fringed silk sash. At 10:30 precisely, the hairdresser bustled in, clutching the instruments of his trade in one hand while he swept a profound bow with the other. Close behind him minced the perfumier and the glove maker, and Héloïse was forced to endure their chatter while they busied themselves about her. The sound of a coach arriving outside made her start, and the hairdresser sighed. His hands darted round Héloïse's carefully coiffed hair as he tucked a final ostrich plume into her diamond aigrette and coaxed a curl to lie just so. Then with a flourish, he removed the sheet that covered Héloïse's shoulders and entreated Mademoiselle to gaze at herself in the mirror. Pale and wooden, her face stared back, and Héloïse made an inarticulate noise. Worried by her mistress's pallor, Marie-Victoire shooed the protesting coterie out of the room. When at last she had closed the door on them, she went over to Héloïse. "There, Mademoiselle, they have gone. Let me get you some wine." Héloïse bent her head, and Marie-Victoire saw that the tears were running unchecked down her cheeks and splashing onto her gown. She hesitated, and then she sank to her knees and took one of Héloïse's hands in her own. Her gesture was so unexpected that Héloïse did not respond for a moment. Sensing her surprise, Marie-Victoire withdrew her hands, but remained kneeling. "Mademoiselle, can I do something?" Héloïse shook her head. Her maid was scarcely the person to help her. But the sight of Marie-Victoire's anxious and sympathetic face brought on a fresh storm of tears. Héloïse was aware of a pair of arms stealing round her, as, heedless of custom, Marie-Victoire drew her close and held her against her shoulder. The reassurance of another giving comfort penetrated through her misery and had the effect of calming Héloïse. Gradually, her sobs quietened. Marie-Victoire got to her feet and left the room. Presently, she reappeared with a tray. She poured some wine into a glass and gave it to Héloïse, who accepted it gratefully.
"Thank you," she said. "This will not happen again."
She cradled the glass between her hands.
"It is only..." "Would you like to tell me, Mademoiselle? It might help."
Héloïse set down her glass and searched on her dressing table for her handkerchief.
"I have told no one of this," she said,
conscious that Marie-Victoire was not the right person to unburden herself to, but enormously relieved at being able to do so.
"But you remember the day my grandmother died at La Joyeuse?"
Marie-Victoire nodded.
"Very well. I had gone into the garden. It is a favourite spot of mine."
She remembered, as if it were yesterday, that day in June at La Joyeuse. Picking her way through the walled kitchen garden, fragrant with gillyflowers and growing herbs. Inside the house, her grandmother, the Maréchale, lay dying, and the de Guinots were clustered in the death chamber, surrounded by candles and stifled by the choking smell of hot wax. She had stood for a long time, gazing at the house and its surrounding lands. It was a satisfying vista of well-tended meadows and woods, set off by a series of formal flowerbeds that swept up to the house in an orderly fashion. The Maréchale had not permitted the Parisian rage for anything English to invade her domain. There was an air of neatness at La Joyeuse. The cattle in the field were sleek, the crops sturdy, and the fields well-managed. Only in the village, straggling further down the valley, did a contrast intrude. Here the cottages, pockmarked by damp and decay, opened their dark interiors onto pitifully small patches of garden, and the children who played in the mud and dirt were thin and sore-encrusted. The flies swarmed everywhere, over the middens, into the houses, and onto the prematurely old faces of their inhabitants. Héloïse had not always been happy at La Joyeuse, but it was dear to her, and she looked affectionately at its tall, classically pure outline that rose to the sky. Her bitterest regret was that one day she would leave it in order to marry. Still, she would inherit a very pretty house near Neuilly from her grandmother, and she looked forward to making that a place of retreat. It was time to go. If she was not careful, she would be missed, and her mother would reprimand her. She lingered for a moment longer by a large stone urn placed at the end of an avenue of rare rose bushes. The early blooms frothed in a riot of scent and colour, mingling with the buds in variations of pink, white, and red, and she smiled with pleasure. The stranger who wandered into the garden, crushing some petals between his fingers as he went, noted the picture Héloïse made with approval. In her black dress, trimmed with a wide ribbon sash, and with her hair swept up to reveal a long neck set off by a necklace of pearls, she made a charming picture. Oblivious of his presence, she bent to snap off a dead flower, and he saw that she was endowed with a face that showed great promise. Waiting beneath its youth and vulnerability was a woman who had as yet to grow into her beauty. But his long experience of women told him that maturity would make that beauty exquisite. Héloïse turned to retrace her steps, and as she did so, she caught sight of the onlooker and stopped. What was he doing, standing there so confidently, almost as if he had the right? She stood rooted by surprise, taking in his well-cut coat, his extravagant lace cravat, and the look of amused arrogance that sat on his features, which, but for the lines of dissipation and a curious discontent, would have been extraordinarily good-looking. It was a cruel visage which revealed that this man knew too much to be at ease with the world or with himself. At that moment, Héloïse sensed that here was someone used to having his own way. She hesitated, but recalled her manners and stepped forward to inquire if she could be of any help. The stranger bowed at her greeting.
"Beautiful gardens and beautiful women always go together," he said, and bent to pick a particularly fine rose, which he presented to Héloïse with a flourish.
She accepted it with nerveless fingers.
"No," he rebuked her, "you must not treat such a fine specimen in such a cavalier fashion."
And leaning over, he retrieved the flower and tucked it into her sash. His hands lingered over her body, almost as if he owned her, and adjusted the bloom to the angle that set it off best. She took a step backwards.
"Monsieur, I would prefer it if you would desist," she said coldly.
He seemed not to heed her.
"That's better," he remarked. "Although on reflection, it is not the precise colour I would have chosen to complement your complexion."
"I think, monsieur, whoever you are, that you had better take your leave," said Héloïse.
There was no mistaking the anger in her voice. The stranger laughed, and Héloïse saw that her anger only added to his enjoyment.
"Spirit and beauty," he said softly, and before she knew what was happening, he had drawn her to him. "How strange," he said, and his eyes were cold. "You remind me of my mother." She was a remarkably beautiful woman.
Héloise was left with the impression of white skin and a pungent, musky smell before she wrenched her face away, so angry she could not speak.
Let me go, she ordered. My father, Monsieur le Marquis, will hear of this.
Your father, my dear, would approve. I speak with the highest authority.
He bent his face to hers and kissed her so ruthlessly that it was impossible for her to prevent him. Her hands flailed at her side while his mouth crawled over hers with an expertise that betrayed extensive practice.
Delightful, he said in the same soft voice. Quite delightful. Fresh, young, and innocent.
You should not have done that,
Héloise managed to say, and raising her hand, she tried to wipe away the imprint of his mouth on hers.
I presume you are a visitor here, she said eventually, but you have betrayed a trust, and I shall not forget it.
She tore at the rose in her sash, now crushed beyond recall, and threw it to the ground where it lay between them. Then, to the sound of the stranger's laughter, she turned on her heel and walked away, praying that her knees would bear her. Once out of sight, she pressed her hands to her hot cheeks, gathered up her skirts and fled, heedless of onlookers, towards the privacy of her room.
So, you will understand how I felt, she said to Marie-Victoire, still shaken by the encounter. When I discovered him to be the man my parents had chosen for me to marry.
Marie-Victoire remained very still. Then she bent to adjust one of Héloïse's stockings.
I do understand, mademoiselle, very well,
she said, drawing it up Héloïse's thigh. The stocking correctly in place, Marie-Victoire rose to her feet and went over to the walnut armoire that held Héloïse's clothes, and retied the embroidered ribbons that held them in tidy piles. Then she tucked some rose petals into the folds and closed the doors.
What would you do if you were me?
It was an odd question for Héloise to ask, but it slipped out before she could prevent it. Marie-Victoire thought before replying.
They say...
Héloise smiled wryly. Of course, the servants always knew everything first.
They say le Monsieur le Comte de Choisy is rich, that he keeps two mistresses, and his first wife died a broken woman. That does not surprise me.
Marie-Victoire turned to face Héloïse.
But it has always been so, has it not, mademoiselle? You must marry and take your place in society. These are things you must do. You are not free to choose. As I am,
she added almost to herself. Héloïse looked hard at her maid, impressed by Marie-Victoire's directness and good sense. She got up and went over to the girl.
Marie-Victoire, will you remain with me in Paris? She asked. I know it would mean leaving La Joyeuse for good, but we shall visit it often. I can arrange it with Madame la Marquise, and I would like it very much.
Marie-Victoire hesitated, but only for a moment. La Joyeuse was too full of unwanted memories for her to wish to go back.
Of course, mademoiselle. It is as my mother would have wished. I shall do my best to serve you well.
Half an hour later, they were summoned downstairs. Marie-Victoire whisked the hare's foot over Héloïse's face for the last time, while impossible thoughts of flight winged through Héloïse's mind, whispering to her that it would be so easy to plead illness or to faint, anything. Then sanity intervened and her pride resurrected itself. After all, she was a de Guinot, and cowardice was not one of her failings. She held out her hand for her fan and walked out of the room. Outside the closed double doors of the salon, there was a rise and fall of voices. The doors opened and the Marquise stood framed in the doorway. She had taken trouble today. And her jewels sparkled on a magnificent silk dress, embroidered with a black and white feather pattern, worn over an underskirt of white satin, sewn with spangles and gold thread. Her normally severe countenance wore a smile.
Come, daughter, she said and held out her hand.
Héloïse did not move.
Shoot,
said the Marquise, her smile vanishing and her face hardening.
You are not about to disgrace us, Héloïse, I hope. Remember, your father and I have looked very carefully into the financial arrangements of this marriage, and they suit us. You will be rich, and your position will be as it should.
She furled her fan and tapped Héloïse sharply on her shoulder. Remember also, she added in an undertone,
if you and Monsieur le Comte do not suit, then you can choose to live apart. Nobody will expect you to be in each other's company all of the time.
Under the pretext of arranging Héloïse's sash, Marie-Victoire gave Héloïse the tiniest push, and Héloïse gathered her courage to begin the long walk down the salon, filled with onlookers, at whose furthest end were grouped her father, the notary, the de Choisy party, and what must be her two English visitors who had arrived late the night before.
What beautiful hair,
she heard someone say. An eternity later, having negotiated the slippery parquet de Versailles in her high-heeled shoes, Héloïse stood in front of her future husband. She raised her eyes. The face from the garden greeted her gaze, its dissipated lines etched harshly in the morning light. De Choisy looked deep into the troubled face of his young and reluctant bride. The situation was exactly as he had predicted, and the fact that Héloïse was obviously unwilling did not displease him. Rather, it mixed a certain piquancy into the situation, and De Choisy was not averse to having his jaded senses teased into life. Héloïse sank into a curtsy, and De Choisy stepped forward and extended an arm clad in olive-green stripes to help her up.
Enchanté, mademoiselle, he said, and then in a voice meant only for her. Or should I say, Madame la Comtesse?
Héloïse's gloved hand shook slightly in his, and it took all of her self-control to bite back the reply.
Not yet.
How pleasant to meet you properly,
he said in the same muted tone.
If Monsieur le Comte is referring to a certain incident at La Joyeuse, then I shall do my best to forget it and trust that it will not be repeated.
De Choisy had the grace to lower his eyes, but Héloïse knew that he was laughing at her, and it stiffened her resolve to speak as little with him as she dared. She turned to her father, who gave the signal for the notary to commence proceedings. The formalities were brief, the contract having been signed the day before, and the settlements already negotiated. Afterwards, Héloïse moved into the receiving line beside her fiancé, and the doors of the salon were thrown open to admit more guests. She nodded and smiled, and submitted to being kissed on both cheeks. But all the time, she felt as if a thin gauze separated her from the world. Out of the corner of her eye, she saw Sophie was besieged by the older generation of de Guinots, and hoped that her cousin would not be too embarrassed by their scrutiny. The guests moved on in well-trained lines. The gossip today, she gathered, was of rents, and of her cousin Narbonne's wish to mortgage a house in Paris in order to pay his debts. The de Guinots were always interested in the subject of rent, and in politics, and just now her father was particularly in demand. Not only had he been summoned to Versailles, to attend the recently convened Estates General, but he also enjoyed a superior knowledge of the English taxation system, a topic currently under hot debate, for a formidable body of French opinion considered it the only model to solve the French financial crisis.
How can they? She thought in despairing, when my heart is breaking.
Bonjour, ma fille.
A well-known voice broke into her thoughts. Héloïse returned the greeting of her favourite great-uncle and relaxed a little. Uncle Albert could always make her laugh. He once told Héloïse that he had been bored stupid in his youth by the constant hectoring of his relations, and in consequence he had resolved never to inflict his views on his own descendants. Albert leant forward to kiss her cheek and squeezed her hand.
Remember, he whispered in her ear, you are dead for a very long time. You must enjoy yourself and use this marriage to your advantage.
Héloïse felt better, and she managed a genuine smile in return. De Choisy was at her elbow.
Come, You have nothing to drink,
he said, steering her over to the sideboard, arranged under a fine still life by Desport. It was laid with a deep blue Sèvres porcelain dinner service, picked out in gold stars and with heavy crystal glasses. At its centre stood a salt cellar made by Cellini at the height of his fame. Héloïse nodded to the servant to pour her some wine and sipped at it while de Choisy accepted another. She murmured her thanks through dry lips, hardly conscious of what she was saying. De Choisy gave a short laugh.
Perhaps the crush is too much for you, mademoiselle. Certainly, this is not the best time to become properly acquainted. But there is time, plenty of time. I want you to know that I look forward to our union.
His words succeeded in piercing her shell. Fear and dislike flooded through her in waves. She struggled for composure, determined not to be outfaced by him.
Tell me about your family, she said with an effort. I'm not yet well acquainted with your circumstances.
De Choisy's face registered approval.
Well done, my dear, he said unexpectedly. You will not be surprised to learn that on account of my vast age, I am nearly 40, I don't have many close relations left.
He proceeded to give her a cleverly articulated sketch of the de Choisys. Héloïse listened, intrigued despite herself by the intelligence that lay behind the throwaway remarks. It seemed inconceivable to her not to be surrounded by a large and inquisitive family, and she wondered vaguely if it might be an advantage.
Come, said de Choisy at last, judging his effect on her to a nicety. I will make a start and introduce you to my sisters.
He led her forward.
This is my eldest sister, Madame Dewar,
he announced. Héloïse found herself being looked up and down by a bored woman who, for all her fashionable dress and deportment, could not hide the fact that she was aging. I do not like you, said Héloïse to herself as the older woman's gaze wandered pointedly over her figure with barely concealed envy.
And this, continued de Choisy, is Madame la Duchesse de Fleury, my youngest sister. Adèle, I shall count on you to be kind to my bride.
Héloïse curtsied to a ravishingly dressed and very pretty blonde whose face expressed concern and interest.
I knew she would be bewitching, cried Adèle,
who had been waiting for the introduction.
And she is Hervé. You are extremely fortunate. I shall look forward to my new sister.
Héloïse dipped a curtsy. No one could fail to respond to Adèle, as her many lovers and friends had so often exasperatedly concluded. Wild, carefree, and unlike her brother and sister, affectionate, she scattered love and money in equal quantities, but accompanied her many sins and omissions with such charming contriteness that few remained angry with her for long. De Choisy stood back, well satisfied that, in an unusual display of consideration for his bride, he had insisted that Adèle be present today. She had not been at all willing, being far more concerned with attending some rout or other at Versailles with her latest lover. But when her brother commanded attendance, she knew better than to protest. Adèle was also pleased with what she saw, not the least because Héloïse's dowry was more than respectable, which meant she might, after all, be able to cajole de Choisy into loosening his purse strings.
I wish to talk to you, she murmured, thinking of a particularly fine pair of diamond earrings that had taken her fancy.
No, said de Choisy before Adèle could embark on her crusade. Definitely not.
Adèle sighed. Hervé was so tight-fisted when it came to his sisters, and had declared more than once that the honour of paying their bills rested with their husbands.
Eh bien,
she said, accepting the inevitable, and turned back to Héloïse.
The girl has real possibilities, she thought to herself, and I like her looks. Welcome to our family, she said. Your parents? Asked Héloïse politely. Have they been dead long?
Adèle paused.
Goodness, yes. My father of overindulgence, and my mother?
She paused again and lowered her voice.
Our mother abandoned us for her lover when we were very young.
It caused a great scandal at the time. Hervé went after her and was found wandering on the road 2 days later. He was well beaten and locked up for a week for a punishment. I don't think he ever forgave her. Of course, being the eldest, he loved her the best. I can't remember her at all.
Adele changed the subject.
When would you be married? She asked, mentally rearranging her wardrobe, a process that tended to involve a complete refurbishment. Héloise furled her fan. In the new year, she replied, and tried to make her tone as light as possible. And will you be taking up a position in the Queen's household? That will be settled later. Héloise had been well instructed by the Marquise. The matter had yet to be finally decided, because the Queen was reluctant to take on a new bride who might at any minute find herself pregnant, and thus unfit for the tiring duties required of her. But I am to be presented after my marriage, she added. Madame de Roy yawned. Her back teeth were quite rotten.
So ennuyant, mademoiselle, she commented, in a lazy drawl reminiscent of her brother's, shutting her mouth quickly. I am afraid you will find it very tedious.
Adele suppressed a smile. Her sister was displaying just the right touch of boredom, so fashionable just now, over the subject of Versailles.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.